Live from our Seven Tasmania studios, your nightly news with Kim Miller begins now.
Good evening, everyone. After nearly 2 years of border closures, Tasmania has welcomed the rest of Australia back into the state, with a steady stream of flights landing in Hobart and Launceston today. There were plenty of tears and hugs galore as loved ones were reunited, some meeting new family members for the very first time. We have full coverage of today's reopening from our reporters across the state as Tasmanians are told it's time to live with COVID. First to Meg Sides, who's at Hobart Airport. Meg, there have been some special moments there today.
Absolutely, Kim. It's been a very emotional day down here at the Hobart Airport. We were here first thing this morning for the very first flight to arrive from Melbourne at around 7:30 in the morning. I don't think there were many dry eyes in the arrivals hall as we covered all of everything that was happening down here, really, as family and friends reunited.
Months of separation all coming down to these moments. Tasmania's borders finally reopening. Colin, one of the first at the Hobart Airport this morning, flowers in hand.
And can you describe the feelings that you're feeling right now?
Can't you see it in my eyes?
An anxious wait ahead of the first flight from Melbourne before this reunion.
Oh, it's brilliant. It was supposed to be 3 months and it's turned out to be 5 months.
Not even those working on our borders were spared the emotion.
I've been given leave just for this, for a few minutes.
This was the moment Paul saw his daughter and granddaughter for the first time in 6 months.
Hello.
Oh, my God. Oh, very teary. I'm so glad that the day has happened. Finally, it's here, isn't it, Isla?
In Launceston, the waterworks started before passengers even disembarked. Tears well and truly flowing once inside.
Guys, it's been so long.
Now able to see each other face to face after hours and hours spent on FaceTime.
It's not the same as that physical hug, yeah.
Families finally celebrating milestones together.
My hand is shaking a bit.
Really emotional, but yeah, really, really happy.
Well, I think you just can't believe that finally they're home.
Others together again after being left separated during the hardest of times.
It's just a very emotional time because we're here to celebrate Dad's life and
Christmas.
And have Christmas together, finally.
Many have battled dozens of cancelled flights.
Here she comes.
Just to get here.
A little bit overwhelmed, yeah. Excited.
It's been a long wait time for reunions like these, but today families will be holding their loved ones close, but no plans of letting go anytime soon.
Oh, it's the best.
It's the best Christmas present ever.
There's no questioning that after months apart, moments like these are absolutely priceless.
And Kim, thousands and thousands of travellers have flooded into the state today, but the people we've spoken to just say they're quite relieved that our borders have opened in time for the festive season. And with Christmas just a little under 2 weeks away, there's going to be plenty more emotional reunions here at the Hobart Airport in the lead-up.
You're too right. Thanks very much, Meg. Well, now to Garth Burley in Devonport, where the spirit of Tasmania is about to arrive. Garth, another shipload of visitors must be a welcome sight for our tourism operators.
Oh, it certainly is, Kim. The second Spirit of Tasmania vessel is about to arrive in here in Devonport, only minutes away. It's one of 11 extra sailings added between now and the end of the year. Now, the first ship coming into Devonport arrived from Melbourne this morning, along with 400 passengers. Now, that is music to the ears of tourism bosses. They say that people that come on the Spirit, they stay here longer, they spend a lot more money, and they visit regional areas untapped, like the West Coast and far south, and it's going to take a lot to help fill a more than $3 billion tourism void.
From the hikes and bikes to our eye-catching natural wonders and tantalising food and wine, Tasmania is once again open for business.
So there's a lot of jobs, there's a lot of businesses hanging on a strong summer. We know the demand's there.
The doors flying open to our two biggest tourism markets after months in exile. Airports flooded with tears and travellers.
The busiest day in terms of flight numbers that Hobart Airport's ever had.
December flight numbers tipped to soar above record levels.
We've actually added about 20% to our overall capacity with the Melbourne-Sydney coming back online again.
It's going to be busier than we've ever been before.
Hire car companies swamped with customers. A similar scenario at Launceston's Balmoral on York Hotel.
From Christmas onwards, the numbers are huge. Biggest we've ever seen.
A summer bookings bonanza, yet healing from the financial suffering triggered by COVID may take some time.
We're not far off $1 million down in revenue going back to March of last year.
Tamar River Cruises is also hoping to refloat its bottom line. It hasn't had a full boat of passengers for 18 months.
Future bookings are looking good, starting to pick up. Far from full, but it's looking good.
Tourism bosses estimate the losses of the last 2 years have snowballed to more than $3 billion. And while today may be a big step forward towards repairing the damage, there's lingering anxiety within the sector. Will we see lockdowns again? Will the government hold its nerve on border restrictions?
The first sign of any sort of softening, people just won't book and won't travel.
And how long until local tourism returns to its former glory? Garth Burley, 7 Tasmania News.
As visitor numbers rise, we're being warned so does the chance of COVID cases returning to our shores. Ainsley Kosh is at a testing clinic in Hobart's outer suburbs. Ainsley, the new clinic has been set up to cope with demand.
That's right, Kim. This testing clinic at the Hobart Showgrounds is one of three new sites to open this week to coincide with the border opening. It should boost our testing capacity to around 5,000 per day, and the average wait time should be around 48 hours for those test results. Now, this is all to keep Tasmanians safe as we return to life in the new normal.
Masked up, ready for a new world order. The health minister inspecting a pathology centre in Launceston, ready to double testing capacity.
We're as prepared as we could possibly be.
But it was the Premier missing from his side, criticised by his political opponents for appearing on breakfast television instead of fronting local media with the Director of Public Health.
It is completely unacceptable that on the day the borders open, the Premier goes missing.
With increasing uncertainty around the Omicron variant and growing case numbers interstate, it's unclear if Tasmanians will face the prospect of future restrictions or if mask wearing will become a daily ritual. The Greens are calling for the borders to close if Tasmania faces an outbreak of its own.
And we hope that the Premier, having made the decision to open our borders today, has the courage and the flexibility to change tack quickly if that's necessary, to pull up the drawbridge.
It's foolish to rule anything in or anything out. So I will not be ruling out any further restrictions.
Police and biosecurity officers will continue to man the borders, there to remind travellers of their requirements. Two people caught unlawfully entering the state by midday. Those who flout the rules can be slapped with fines in excess of $1,500.
We don't want to issue those. We want people to do the right thing and we encourage people to do the right thing. But if it's required, we will issue those.
From today, vaccinated travellers are welcomed into the state with open arms, while visitors spending more than 8 days in a high-risk area will need to produce a negative COVID test 72 hours prior to departure. Vaccinated travellers coming from a low-risk zone need to register their details through the TAS eTravel website. As for vaccinated international passengers, a negative COVID test is required 72 hours prior to arriving, then 7 days of quarantine awaits. Ainsley Kosh, 7 Tasmania News.
Well, he came without Christmas stocking fillers, but Anthony Albanese has unofficially kicked off what's set to be a long election campaign. Visiting a high-end manufacturer in a marginal seat, the Labor leader pipped Liberal ministers in the race to be seen in this state. Now borders are open.
Off the first flight into Launceston and straight to industrial Invermay.
Checked in.
To check out Definium Technologies and spread some pre-Christmas goodwill.
To in person congratulate Tasmanians on what they have achieved during the COVID pandemic.
What Anthony Albanese needs to achieve is a strong reversal of 2019's election disaster, where Labor lost two Tasmanian seats. They've recycled Ross Hart for Bass, while Burnie councillor Chris Lynch will go for Braddon.
The Prime Minister's chosen to have a very long election campaign. Well, I welcome that.
Arriving empty-handed in terms of financial promises, the touchdown on border opening day pips Liberal counterparts who will be filing in en masse in the days to come.
Our vision for a future made in Australia.
Something Definium takes to the next level, made in Tasmania. Only this week, it doubled production of high-tech tracking devices for equipment hire company Coates.
We generally try to get customers to tell us what they want and we build what they need.
And with both parties needing Tasmania's vote once again, expect a lot more meet and greets and show and tells in the coming months. Tom Johnson, 7 Tasmania News.
Brisbane prison correctional officers have once again walked off the job today, continuing their calls for more staff and safer working conditions. Around 120 employees taking part in another stop work meeting, asking the state government to boost staffing levels said to be dangerously low.
Lockdown's happening too regularly. We're seeing inmates not being able to be rehabilitated before they go back into the community, and we're seeing safety pushed to the limits.
This government has the fantasy that they're going to open a remand centre early in 2022 that's going to require 50 additional staff, yet on a daily basis they cannot fill the units that they currently have, and they put that pressure back on officers.
A government spokesperson says today's actions are disappointing and 237 extra correctional officers have joined the prison system since 2016, with more recruitment ongoing. There was a lucky escape for a driver in Sandy Bay this morning after their car flipped onto its roof. The crash happened on Regent Street near Fitzroy Crescent just before 10 a.m. The road was blocked while emergency services worked to get the car back on its wheels before clearing the scene. The driver wasn't injured. An unattended campfire on the state's northwest coast has prompted safety warnings from authorities. A blaze destroyed a caravan and a small boat on a Port Cyril property around 1 o'clock this afternoon. The Tasmania Fire Service is urging anyone cooking outdoors or lighting a campfire during warm conditions to be vigilant and to remain in attendance. Campfire restrictions come into effect this week. A new national NAP plan report has revealed Tasmania is still lagging behind most other jurisdictions in education results. The data also showing students from major cities across the country are outperforming regional and remote pupils in literacy and numeracy, while achievements in regional areas are significantly higher than remote and very remote students. Meanwhile, relief has come for 11,000 Tasmanian senior students who received their exam results and TCE scores today. New game-changing technology has arrived in a Tasmanian school to help seriously ill students stay connected. The CB robot service allows children to join classes direct from their hospital bed.
Taking a tour of the classroom on wheels. 6-year-old George operating his new school alter ego for when he misses class due to treatment.
George was diagnosed with brain cancer when he was 11 months of age. So we've been on and off treatment for 5.5 years now. George spent the whole kinder year not being connected to anyone apart from the one-on-one teacher.
The Zooming electronic tablet, tested out by George over the past 6 months. The CB robot service allowing him to see, hear, speak up and even kick a ball in class, with more interstate hospital stints and recovery back at home on the horizon.
The anxiety of being able to come back to school when he might have spent some time off. We're hoping that in the future he's not going to have those issues because of the fact he's still part of actually physically being part of the classroom.
It's great because all of his friends can see him and he can see them as well, and he can move the robot to see what he needs around the classroom.
The device, now here at Howard Primary School, helped by funding from Aurora Energy through the Missing Schools project.
We were just delighted to give them $10,000 to support them in bringing their technology to Tasmania and allowing children like George to stay connected.
Particularly for students that are going to be away for long periods of time, staying connected is such an important thing for their well-being and their overall happiness.
Ruby Kamane, 7 Tasmania News.
Becoming a train driver is, for some, a childhood dream. But have you ever wondered what it's like living life on the train line? As the 150th anniversary of Rail in Tasmania draws to a close, we took a special trip alongside one of the state's veteran drivers.
For David Payne, a love of locomotives is in the blood.
I come from a farming background, so I love tractors, so
these things here are just a big tractor, basically.
Except this one is hauling over 1,000 tonne of coal. Yet that's only half the size of what David usually drives.
Lots of aluminium, zinc.
For 42 years, he's weaved his way through Tasmania's terrain, although this year has been noteworthy. It's the 150th anniversary of the state's first line between Launceston and Deloraine. Fittingly, our trip was steeped in history. We crossed Longford's classic wrought iron bridge, which was part of that original line, plus the Flinty Creek Viaduct, which safely carried trains over the South Esk for more than a century, and a logging yard, once Longford's land of locomotives until the late 70s. Back then, David had to improvise when things went wrong.
Our locos are on a steep grade, they'd be slipping in the wet, so you'd empty your lunch box and scoop some sand into that and tip on the top of the rails.
Nothing like the checks and balances today.
200+1.
Although perhaps the most significant safety feature is also the simplest. Drivers keep pressing the vigilance button, once called the dead man's pedal, to show they haven't died or had a medical episode on the job. Just about everything else comes down to skill and experience.
A good driver can feel the train through his backside, where he sits in the seat essentially. You know when something's not right, you can just feel it.
For many of us, there's a certain romance around rail. It's inspired television shows, books, and of course tourists who travel around the world to live the globe's greatest lines. So for David, being a part of that world really is something special. Even on this trip, keen train spotters dotted the line. This interaction he enjoys. But when people take risks around train lines, and especially level crossings, is a different story.
For the person driving the train, it's something they take home with them at the end of their shift.
Luckily, those days are in the minority.
It's a job I enjoy. I don't always feel like it's a job because I enjoy it so much.
A track record he hopes to keep intact for years to come. Tom Johnson, 7 Tasmania News.
Aussie World Cup hero Mitch Marsh remains an outside chance of a test call-up this summer after smashing an unbeaten century off just 60 balls against the Hobart Hurricanes, which included 5 monster sixes.
Flicks him leg side.
Take a bow, Mitch Marsh. What a knock, what a shot.
A fan was left bloodied after a crowd catch gone wrong as the Scorchers won by 53 runs. Meanwhile, the Jack Jumpers have a huge test ahead against reigning champion the Perth Wildcats. Guard Jared Weeks says they've been reviewing the tape following a flat loss to Cairns.
It's definitely hard in the change room after the game. After a loss like that, you just want to learn from it. You know, we've seen what we need to do and we've implemented that at practice this week.
It'll be Coach Scott Roth's first regular season clash against his old side. The game is on Sunday in Perth. Somerset's Kyron Bacon has landed a pro contract for next year's Australian Off-Road Championship. The 19-year-old has signed with Yamaha, where he'll race in the 250cc E1 division, with his aggressive riding style turning heads on the national stage. He's one of 4 riders being contracted by Yamaha, which will have 2 trucks on site at each round. Wynyard will host the championship's finale in October. And some great news to finish sport out of the Northwest. Smithton will have a football team once again in the Northwest Football League. The Circular Head Saints, which went into recess in 2019 as the Giants, will return to the field next year following a vote at the league's AGM overnight. The club will field senior and under-18 sides in 2022 and look to include reserves and women's sides the following year. What a fantastic story. The club's over 100 years old, Kim. In fact, when they went under in 2019, it was the 100th year of the club. So to see them running around next year is excellent news for footy in the Northwest.
Good evening. Temperatures today were around or slightly above average. Hobart right on the December average with 20. Launceston and Burnie 25 today and Devonport 21. Warmest was Cressy's 26. Friendly Beaches and Bushy Park 24. St Helens 23. Smithton 22. Lyaweenie and Lowhead both on 21. Strawn 20 and the Bass Strait Islands 19. High cloud did stream over the northeast today. Patchy lower cloud over the west, central and south. A band of cloud stretches from northern WA right through the nation to our northeast, some isolated thunderstorms being generated over northern Australia. Tomorrow, an area of high pressure moves over Tasmania. A low develops over southern WA associated with the trough, which extends up and around to Queensland. Winds basically a mix from the southwest at 20 to 30 knots, easing before becoming more variable, a swing back to the southwest in the evening. Hobart, a top of 20 tomorrow and partly cloudy. 21 for Cygnet, partly cloudy for Norfolk, 22 the maximum. Launceston, 24 and sunny. Devonport, 21 and 23 for Campbelltown, fine and clear. Burnie, sunny and 22. 18 the top for Strawn, bit of cloud about, but fine, and 21 the high for Smithton. St Helens, partly cloudy and 18, up to 20 for Swansea, and Fingal, mostly sunny, 21 degrees. UV, for the first time this season, expected to be peaking at over 11, which in Burnie is extreme. On Friday, a fine day with mostly light winds. A hot one on Saturday, Hobart, Cygnet and New Norfolk all in the 30s. And on Sunday, showers over the west extending statewide during the day. Partly cloudy for Perth. A sunny 30 in Adelaide, fine in Melbourne, a possible shower over Sydney. 31 degrees in Brisbane, a possible storm in Darwin. Bit of cloud over Hobart at 17 at the moment, still warm in Launceston, 21 currently and 20 right now in Devonport. And by the way, Kim, Merry Christmas to you. It's a bit early, but I may not see you before then.
You're off on holidays and I don't think I get to see you again until next year. Have a lovely break, much deserved. We'll see you next year. And that is all your news for now. We'll be back later with updates. Thanks for joining us this evening. Good night.